We pray for blessings. We pray for peace. Comfort for family. Protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity, and we pray for your mighty hand to ease our suffering. And all the while, you hear each broken need, yet love is way too much to give us lesser things. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? And what if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? And what if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? When friends betray us, when darkness seems to win, we know the pain reminds this heart that this is not our home. It's not our home. What if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? And what if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? And what if my greatest disappointments or the achings of this life is the revealing of a greater thirst this world can't satisfy? And what if trials of this life, the rain, the storms, the hardest nights, are your mercies in disguise?
To begin with, let us hear an inspirational message from our beloved and supportive OIC of the Office of the Schools Division Superintendent of Dasmariñas, Mr. Raymundo M. Cantonjos.
My greetings and congratulations to the health and education unit of the City Schools Division of Dasmariñas in this week-long activity on Oplan Kalusugan, dubbed as OK sa DepEd, in this year's One Health Week celebration on September 6 to 11, 2021. My greetings and thanks also to our school principals, teachers, nurses, health teachers, and members of the Health and Nutrition Unit in the SDO, schools, and field offices for the support and cooperation to this activity and the series of the many activities for this week and our many activities year-round. Recognizing the importance of promoting and practicing program and activities for the health and wellness of our learners and teachers, let us continue to collaborate and work together for the welfare of our learners
okay. O plan kalusugan sa DepEd. Halina't alamin atin ang tuklasin. Mga health programs ating palaganapin. Tara na okay na okay. O plan kalusugan sa DepEd. Halina't alamin atin ang tuklasin. Mga health programs ating palaganapin. School-based feeding program, ating pagtibayin. Wastong pagkain, ating ihahain. Mga batang kulang sa timbang, ating pagkakainin. Nang go, grow, and blow. Adolescent reproductive health ay gawing gabay at patnubay ng batang mausisa ay di maranasan. Ang early pregnancy ay maiiwasan. Kalusugan ay mahalaga sa edukasyon ng mga bata. Tayo na't mag-asa, halina tayo sumama. Tara na okay, o plan kalusugan sa DepEd. Halina't alamin atin ang tuklasin. Mga health programs ating palaganapin. Tara na okay, o plan kalusugan sa DepEd. Halina't alamin atin ang tuklasin. Mga health programs ating palaganapin. National Drug Education Program or NDEP kung tawagin. Ito'y paiktingin mga bisyo'y alisin. Sigarilyo at droga ay dapat nang buksain. Water sanitation and hygiene in schools, ating kompletuhin. Three stars ay abutin. Malinis na tubig, segregated na toilet, group hand washing at may napkin na rin. Kalusugan ay mahalaga sa edukasyon ng mga bata. Tayo na mag-asa, halina tayo sumama. Tara na okay, o plan kalusugan sa DepEd. Halina't alamin atin ang tuklasin. Mga health programs ating palaganapin. Tara na okay, o plan kalusugan sa DepEd. Halina't alamin atin ang tuklasin. Mga health programs ating palaganapin. Medical, dental, and nursing services na ating ding binibigay upang matugunan problemang pangkalusugan ng mga guro at kabataan. Kalusugan ay mahalaga sa edukasyon ng mga bata. Tayo na't mag-asa, halina tayo sumama. Tara na okay, o plan kalusugan sa DepEd. Halina't alamin atin ang tuklasin. Mga health programs ating palaganapin. Tara na okay, o plan kalusugan sa DepEd. Halina't alamin atin ang tuklasin. Mga health programs ating palaganapin. Tara na okay, o plan kalusugan sa DepEd. Halina't alamin atin ang tuklasin. Mga health programs ating palaganapin.
A pleasant day to all. The 2021 One Health Week of the Department of Education officially started last September 6, 2021 and will end on September 11, 2021. This celebration aims to promote and highlight DepEd's flagship programs under the Oplan Kalusugan sa DepEd or Okay sa DepEd. One of its flagship programs is the National Drug Education Program. NDEP is a comprehensive educational program which provides for a holistic approach to the problem of drug abuse. It is implemented in schools to create awareness on the ill effects of abusing drugs and to develop among students positive behavior and life skills to resist drugs.
Mga Lodi, ngayong araw ay isang importanteng bagay ang tatalakayin natin at ito ay tungkol sa pag-iwas sa droga. Alam niyo ba mga Lodi na ang paggamit ng droga ay maraming masamang epekto hindi lamang sa ating sarili kundi ganun din sa mga taong nakapaligid sa atin. Kapag tayo ay gumamit nito at nagkaroon ng tinatawag na drug addiction, maaari tayong makaramdam ng iba't ibang side effects nito. Katulad ng mood swings at depression, confusion, hallucination, pagkakaroon ng mental complications at marami pang iba. Marami ding mga sakit ang maaari nating makuha dito. Alam niyo ba maaari tayong makakuha ng HIV o Human Immunodeficiency Virus, hepatitis, heart attack, kidney at liver damage, stroke, brain damage, at higit sa lahat, maaari natin ikamatay kapag naabuso ang paggamit ng droga. At dahil maaapektuhan ng husto ng droga ang ating pag-iisip, maaari tayong makagawa ng hindi mabuting gawain sa ating kapwa nang hindi natin namamalayan. Kaya naman mga Lodi, narito ang ilan sa mga maaari natin gawin upang maiwasan ang droga. Pumasok sa eskwelahan at mag-aral ng mabuti. Piliin ang sasamahang mga kaibigan. Mas mainam kung mumuo tayo ng isang barkada na may magandang impluwensya sa isa't isa. Maglaan tayo ng oras sa ating pamilya. Kahit manis ko pala, huwag kalimutan ng oras sa ating mga magulang at mga kapatid. Mag-isip tayo ng mga bagay na maaari nating pagkalibangan na makatutulong sa atin upang paglinangin ang ating sarili nang sa gayon ay hindi maimpluwensyahan ng hindi mabuting gawain. Ilan sa mga halimbawa nito ay ang paggamit ng talento tulad ng pagkanta o pagsayaw. Maaari ka rin maglaan ng oras sa pag-travel, sports, gym, at marami pang iba. Kung may mabibigat na problema ang pinagdadaanan, mabuting kumausap ng isang mabuting kaibigan o ng mas nakatatanda para tayo ay mapangaralan ng mga tamang hakbang na dapat natin gawin at hindi maging dahilan ng mga maling desisyon gaya ng paggamit ng droga. Ibaling ang pag-iisip sa mga positibong bagay at ating pangarap sa buhay. At higit sa lahat, huwag kalimutan na magpasalamat sa Diyos.
Dep Ed Das Mariñas is one with the department needs commitment to promote the national drug education program.
Good day, this is Lau Jean from EDIHS and an advocate of Kid Movement. We, Kid Movement, along with BKD and our partner schools, believe that we can contribute in uplifting the lives of our youth by pursuing our advocacy. By continuously educating the students and youth sector through DAVE, or Drug Awareness and Violence Education, education campaign, we aim to exercise and improve on positive discipline guidelines, youth participation.
Last year, the Department of Education launched the very first NDEP webinar series, which aims to provide information on NDEP amidst the COVID-19 pandemic. The second run of the webinar series is currently ongoing.
Tuwa kayo kasi yung mga in-invite.
Last year, the Department of Education launched the very first NDEP webinar series, which aims to provide information on NDEP amidst the COVID-19 pandemic. The second run of the webinar series is currently ongoing. Join us in rewatching one of the most relevant episodes of the NDEP webinar series last year.
Tuwa kayo kasi yung mga in-invite po natin are really involved in drug prevention at mayroon silang mga contribution sa mga katulad ng Philippine Anti-Drug Strategy at iba pang mga initiatives na may kinalaman sa drug education and prevention. Yan. Ngayon naman po makakarinig tayo ng isang mensahe para po bigyan ng context itong ating ginagawa. Bakit tayo merong episode na ito? Bakit tayo merong webinar series? Allow me to formally introduce, although nakita niyo na po siya kanina, to give us her message. She is a medical doctor by profession and has been in the public health sector for already 26 years. She earned her master's degree in public health through a scholarship from the University of the Philippines, Manila, her medical degree from St. Louis University in Baguio City, and her bachelor's degree in biology from the Mariano Marcos State University, Ilocos Norte. Throughout her work, she has been awarded various international scholarships, including the Diploma in Biochemical and Health Information in Mahidol University, Bangkok, Thailand, the Harm Reduction Program course in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia, course on strategies in life skills development for adolescents in Kasetsar, Thailand, and just recently, the training on drug demand reduction for global trainers in Vienna, Austria. Aside from her current position, she is also engaged in local and international organizations in various capacity. She is the governing board member for the Southeast Asian Ministers of Education Regional Center for Food and Nutrition, or SIMIOREFON. She is an advisor for the Private School Health Officers Association, or PSHOA, an alumna of the Asian Institute of Management on the Leadership Development course, a global master trainer of the Colombo Plants Universal Prevention Curriculum on Substance Use, through which she has already served as a trainer in countries including Malaysia, Dubai, Fiji, Thailand, Myanmar, and South Africa. Kaya, mapalad po tayo kapag meron tayong mga UPC workshops in the past that she has served as one of our resource persons. She is also a global trainer on drug demand reduction of the United Nations Office Drugs and Crime. She is a certified mediator of the department, and her expertise is always constantly sought in development of drug education programs and initiatives. Just recently, UPC initiative on school setting. So, sa ating mga kasama sa DepEd Philippines Facebook page, let's welcome the Chief Health Program Officer of the School Health Division under the Bureau of Learner Support Services. Let's welcome Dr. Maria Corazon Dumlao.
Again, good afternoon to all our viewers. Welcome to the first of the 10 webinar series for the National Drug Education Program. You know, it is exciting to note that despite this COVID-19 pandemic, we are committed to deliver our advocacies on drug prevention. Just the same with other OKD programs, we will utilize various platforms in this new normal to continue to update you or provide you with the information on our health programs. Our topic for this webinar is timely since next month, it is already the start of the school year, though it is entirely different from the previous school openings because we shifted to various learning modalities. Let us reflect on how school setting plays an important role in substance use prevention. The school-based prevention interventions is a part of the 9-series curriculum of the Universal Prevention Curriculum for Substance Use. The training series is developed through funding from the U.S. Department's State of Colombo Plan for International Center for Credentialing and Education of Addiction Professionals. This topic introduces the concept that schools provide the second most important setting for prevention after the family. Their role in most societies is to help prepare our children and youth to become fully contributing members of families, workplaces, communities, and society. You know, we are indeed lucky that our speaker, lahat ng mga guests natin at saka yung ating speaker ay napaka-knowledgeable and experienced in this topic. Yung ating main speaker ay isang professor herself and she's one of the global master trainers of the UPC at kasama ko rin siya ng ilang beses sa paglalakbay as a global master trainer and I know that you will learn a lot from her. Pero alam niyo po, ang pinakamahalaga kanina, yung inspirasyon na ibinigay sa atin ni Yusek and dahil ako'y na-inspire, gusto kong ibigay na lang yung aking mensahe sa pamamagitan ng impronto na tula, napipilitin ko siyang gawing impronto using the word, yung initials ng substance use. So for the S, sabay-sabay nating iparamdam ang ating pakikiisa sa pamamagitan ng paglalagay ng puso sa chat box. Pwede po ba? Usaping school-based intervention, ating ngayong biglang sentro, bigyang sentro at halaga, bata, matanda, anuman ang antas at profesyon sa bansa, sadyang mahalaga ang gagampanan sa OKD at sa DDB na programa. T, tandaan natin na health and safety ang pundasyon ng ating gawa. A, alamin ang iba't ibang pamamaraan sa pag-iwas sa masamang dulot ng droga. Yung letter N, new normal ating haharapin at strategies iba, pwede rin nating ibahin. Best practices, sabi nga ni Yusek, paigtingin. Compassion sa mga gumagamit, atin ding damhin at intindihin. Exciting, di ba? Kasi 27,000 viewers na tayo ngayon. Di po ba exciting yon? And sa U, unawain ang substance use. Una yon sa ating nilalayon. S, social stigma. Ito ay kailangang buwagin ng ating mga UPC advocates or trained advocates, UPC trainers. Letter E, enhanced partnership with DDB, with ATCPDE, at ibang mga sektor sa gobyerno, ating paigtingin. So, yung last, yung prevention, ang pwede nating, ang pwede kong sabihin ay prevention sana, tuloy-tuloy, prevention sama all sa edukasyon, substance free, sana all. So, sana po ma-enjoy niyo po itong ating gagawin at sana po sa lahat ng mga susunod na series natin ay we can still follow at makipag-participate po dito dahil sa pandemic na ito, kayo po ang pinakamahalaga at nasa kamay niyo po ang lakas, nasa kamay niyo po ang power to make a difference in the lives of our school children at saka members of the community dahil sa iyong pagiging advocate ng substance use. Magandang hapon po sa inyong lahat and again, welcome to this
Hey,
Ayan. Thank you very much po, Dr. Dumlao. Ayan, so sana pinapakinggan natin even itong mga opening activities na to, no? Mamaya pupunta tayo sa technical discussion, pero ang ganda ng mga opening reminders natin sa ating pagbubukas, yung acronym na binigay ni Doc on substance use prevention, and even yung emphasis on compassion. To all people, whether they are using drugs or not, meron tayong pagtingin o pag-unawa na kaya natin silang matulungan. At meron tayong magagawa even sa prevention para sa mga hindi pa gumagamit. So it's really an exciting start for all of us para sa isa ating episode 1 ng webinar series. Thank you for this good start. Marami po tayong nag-register and I understand some of them will be watching later. So kung kayo ay nanonood through the recording, I hope na take note nyo pa rin itong mga opening messages na ito and yung mga inspiring reminders sa atin that we are in this NDEP webinar in the first place because we value the life of people around us, of the people we care for. So whether there is pandemic or even before the pandemic or kung wala mang pandemic, ay ito yung motivation natin. So thank you very much po, Dr. Dumlao, for that message. So alam po, excited na kayo na makinig para sa ating lecture, pero meron na lang tayong konting reminder bago ipakilala yung ating speaker for this afternoon. Gusto lang muna namin kayong i-remind na kung meron kayong comments or questions or any feedback, insights na gusto ninyong i-share, you have the option to type them on the comment section, pero we understand na sobrang bilis kasi mag-move ng comment section sa DepEd Philippines Facebook page. So we have set up this form where you can log in and type your feedback. So it's bit.ly/2020NDEP web series feedback. You just go to this Google form and during the lecture, kung meron kayong insights mula sa pinapresent ng ating resource person or kung meron kayong question na ma-create sa mind ninyo or kung meron kayong gustong i-clarify, just go to this link and type your comments, your questions, insights, or any other feedback, ilagay nyo po dyan sa form na yan. We will be closely monitoring this form and titingnan po natin kung ano yung mga feedback na meron kayo so that when we go to the question and answer portion later toward the end of this broadcast, babalikan po natin yung mga tanong ninyo and i-raise po natin sa ating resource person. And so to formally introduce our resource person this afternoon, let me call on the National Program Coordinator for the National Drug Education Program, Ms. Girly Azurin.
Hello, thank you, Yuyan. Yes, thank you, Yuyan. Magandang hapon po sa inyong lahat. It is my honor to introduce our speaker. She serves as director of the ASEAN Training Center for Preventive Drug Education at the University of the Philippines, where she also teaches health education courses in the College of Education. In 2018, she spearheaded a training program to develop the personal and social skills of Filipino high school students in 3 public schools in Metro Manila through peer education. As a global prevention trainer, she has been involved in capacity building activities sponsored by the Colombo Plan in Austria, Colombia, Fiji, Kenya, Malaysia, Sri Lanka, Thailand, United Arab Emirates, and of course, the Philippines. She assists the Department of Education in developing health-related policies and the Dangerous Drugs Board in crafting the Philippine Anti-Illegal Drugs Strategy or PAD. Friends, let us all welcome Professor Francis Grace H. Duca Pante.
Good afternoon, everyone. I hope you can hear me.
We can hear you.
Thank you so much, Ms. Gurley, for that kind introduction. I am so blessed to be with you this afternoon to share with you my knowledge on the school as an important setting for substance use prevention. This topic is very close to my heart. So since 2012, I have been serving as a director of the ASEAN Training Center for Preventive Drug Education. For those of you who are not familiar with the office, this is located in the third on the third floor of the University of the Philippines in Diliman, Quezon City, College of Education. I know that Gian already did a feelings check, but I know that many of us experience different kinds of emotions. So as you can see, we have here the animal moods. A is for sad, and B is for happy, and C is for grumpy. And I know that many of us can relate with these animal moods. The main point of this slide is for us to remember that whatever you are feeling right now is totally normal and valid. Before I proceed to the main points of this presentation, I would like to express my gratitude to the School Health Division of the Department of Education, led by Dr. Maria Corazon Dumlao. She's a very good friend of mine. We've been together for a long time because of the UPC. And of course, to Ms. Gurley Asurin, the NDEP coordinator, and to Mr. Gian Ada, who is a very effective facilitator. So thank you so much for inviting me. I'm so blessed to be the first resource person for this series of webinars for the National Drug Education Program. I'm so excited. And although this is a very new modality for us, I'm not used to talking alone, just facing my laptop. But I assume that you are listening right now. And I hope that you would be able to learn a thing or two from this presentation. So the presentation for now will cover four subtopics. The first one is the prevention context. The second is the principles of effective prevention interventions. The third one, we are going to focus on the school as a target setting for prevention. And the last one would be examples of school evidence-based practices. So we're going to review the international standards on drug use prevention. For those of you who are familiar with the universal prevention curriculum, I know that many of you who are watching right now are NDEP coordinators who were trained in the UPC. Thank you so much for watching. This is going to be a review or a refresher for you. But for the rest who are not familiar with the UPC, don't worry. I have prepared this presentation to cover the basics as well as the current trends in prevention in the school setting. So I hope you are now ready. So the objectives of today's presentation include, number one is to describe why the school is an important setting for substance use prevention. So Dr. Dumlao mentioned a while ago that next to the family, the school is a very important setting for prevention and advocacy. The second objective is to discuss the importance of the school culture and climate as a foundation for academic achievement and substance use prevention. So later on, we are going to focus on the importance of the emotional climate in the school and how does this impact academic achievement. And the last one is to specify key roles that schools can play in substance use prevention. So this will focus on three roles that schools should play, okay? And I know that many of you are familiar with this. Again, this is just going to be a review for the majority. So let me start off with a learning opportunity. This is a sad story that I have. It's a painful experience when I was new in the College of Education in UP. I was asked to teach a course, EDH-130, that is Consumer Health Education and Drug Education. So I was so excited handling that course because it was my first time in the college after teaching the UP Integrated School for almost 5 years. So one afternoon, one of my students told me that he has a friend, okay, who is a former user. And he told me, "Mom, is it okay if we invite my friend to talk about his experience?" And I told him, "Wow, that's a good idea. So let's invite your friend and let's discuss, okay, about his experience." So he invited his friend, and that friend, I clearly remember that afternoon when the friend went inside the class and talked about his amazing experience with drugs. And he just kept on talking about the experience, about the richness when it comes to colors and receptions when he took this drug. And I was so I couldn't actually explain my emotions during that time. I was so shocked, okay? And I'd like to cut him off during the middle of the talk, but I couldn't. So I just freezed and I told myself I made a big mistake. So after that activity, I went to debrief my students and ask them, so how was it? And it was actually to my horror that they said, Mom, it's okay to use drugs. So you see, the whole point of the activity was actually defeated. Because of course, my objective in inviting a former user is for my students to be discouraged from using substances. But what happened is exactly the opposite. They were encouraged to use. And when I asked them why, they told me that because it was an amazing experience for that student, for that young person. And he looks like an actor. He was actually, he has a flawless skin. He was so expressive. And we just liked him. So we're going to follow his example and use substances. And maybe when we do, and then when we stop, you can also invite us in the class. And then we will also give a testimonial. So you see, even though our intentions as teachers and as prevention advocates, you may have very good intention, but if the strategy is something that is ineffective, then we defeat the purpose. So I wish I knew that using testimonials of former drug users is an ineffective approach. So that was actually a great lesson that I've learned more than a decade ago. So please, for teachers who are listening right now, the use of former drug users, okay, to give testimonials in your classes is actually ineffective because it sends mixed messages, okay, that it's okay to use because they can stop and then in the future they might get invited to give a testimonial. So please don't do that. So the prevention issue is that, unfortunately, there are still prevention programs and interventions being done which are not based on what works. So if you ask people, why are you doing this particular school-based prevention program? They would tell you, because we've been doing this for decades, because this is a tradition already. And if you ask them, is it effective? They don't have the evidence. They would just tell you, oh, we have anecdotal evidence. But if you're familiar with evidence-based practice, they need randomized controlled trial, okay? The gold standard, so that you will be able to provide the evidence that that particular program works. So it is very sad that money and other resources are being invested on ineffective approaches. And through this presentation, I hope that you will be able to get a grasp of what is available that are actually effective and have been proven to work in different settings across countries in the world. So here's an important note before we proceed. Prevention can be harmful. It's shocking, right? Because we know that prevention works if it's done correctly, but prevention can also be harmful if incorrectly applied or implemented. So again, we may have very good intentions, but if we have faulty or ineffective strategy in carrying it out, it might be harmful instead of beneficial. So let me give you an example. I have here two images, very common. Okay, I have here drug aware, and the other one is Say No to Drugs. The Say No to Drugs campaign is very popular. It started in the US 1980s, and then until now, we can see this poster, Say No to Drugs. What is problematic about this poster? It assumes that it is easy to say no. When it comes, it's not. When in fact, it's not, right? It's actually difficult to refuse, especially when that person who is offering you something that is unhealthy is a very good friend of yours. It's actually very hard to refuse. So saying no to drugs, that poster is not enough. you should tell the person, especially our young people, how do you say no to drugs? So we need to tell them how. And it shouldn't be so much directive. It's just like a command. And we know that young people don't like that. They don't want to be told on what to do. Okay? So the message, say no to drugs, let's teach our young people how to say no to drugs. And there are different kinds of strategies, right? You can just firmly look at the person, okay, eye contact, and firmly say no. You can actually make up excuses. There are a lot of excuses. You can actually use cold shoulder, right? So you pretend not to hear the person. Or you can also make use of broken record technique. You tell or you say no as many times as needed. So these are just some of the strategies that you can use, okay, in teaching our young people, our kids, on how to refuse when somebody offers them a dangerous substance. Okay, for now, I would like to ask, okay, for a moment, I'd like you to take this knowledge check. Okay, I only have here four statements, and what you're going to do is just to determine whether this is true or false, okay? And number one is all drugs are bad. Is this a true or a false statement? Second one is legal drugs are generally safe. Third statement, drug users are not morally weak. And last statement, majority of people are non-users. Okay, can I give you 10 seconds to write down your answers? Just write T or F. Your 10 seconds starts now. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Time is up. Okay, so let's see. Number one, all drugs are bad. This is a false statement because we all know that medicines are drugs, right? So medicines have therapeutic or curative properties, and they are also drugs. So not all drugs are bad. So this is a false statement. Number two, legal drugs are generally safe. This is another false statement. Legal drugs include tobacco and alcohol, and we all know that these legal substances are actually very dangerous, okay? It has a lot of negative effects on our health and well-being. Number three, drug users are not morally weak. This is a true statement. They are not morally weak. Actually, behavior is a very complex thing. It is affected by a lot of factors. So using drugs cannot actually be explained by just one factor. It has a lot of factors, okay? And we are going to talk about that later. So this is a true statement. Number four, majority of people are non-users. Another true statement, okay? So I hope that you were able to get a perfect score. One and two are both false. Three and four are both true statements. Give yourself a pat on the back if you were able to get four out of four. Congratulations. Let's now move on to the term review. So this is the term review part. And I know that for those who took the UPC course, this is very basic. So now we're going to differentiate drug use from substance use. Okay, so in the past, when we say drugs, okay, this is any substance that has effects on the body and on the brain, okay, when taken. But, and later on, drugs have been associated with illegal drugs of use. Okay, so when we say drug use, we usually think of the use of marijuana or shabu. So society has actually changed, okay, the concept of drugs from simply unsafe to relating it with something that is illegal. That is drugs, okay? But when we talk about substance use, this is the use of psychoactive substances. So when we say psychoactive substance, this is a substance that impacts the brain, okay? So it alters the structure or the function of the brain. And surprisingly, It includes tobacco and alcohol, the illegal drugs of abuse, inhalants, and other non-medical use of prescription medications. So please remember that if you are a smoker or an alcohol drinker, then you are considered a substance user, because substance use is a general term. So it's an umbrella concept that covers everything, okay? From tobacco to alcohol to illegal drugs to inhalants to even the non-medical use of prescription medications. So I hope that the term substance use is now clear to you. Okay, remember that it's a general term that covers tobacco and alcohol. So let's look at the prevention context. So it's actually a very young field, no? Prevention science, a very young field. But when it comes to the context of prevention, we say that it is the application of prevention science to address the health and safety of individuals through improving socialization. Please remember that concept, socialization and socialization processes, to enhance self-realization and participation in society. It's very important that I highlighted socialization, because we learned, okay, we learn our norms, okay, many of our behaviors through socialization. And the school is a very important socialization agent. The DepEd School Health Division came up with a very nice diagram, okay, showing the importance of substance use prevention, okay? So you can see from here that the objective of substance use prevention is to help people, okay, particularly our adolescents, in order to avoid or prevent initiation of substance use or delay initiation of substance use. And if they're already using, to prevent disorders. So remember, prevention is preventing initiation. So you refrain from using psychoactive substances. You don't start using. That is the primary objective. If we can discourage people from using psychoactive substances, at least we delay their initiation. So instead of starting at age 10, we delay that for a decade. So at least they start at 20, or better if they start after 20 years or after 30 years. So prevent initiation, if not, at least delay initiation. If they are already using, then prevent progression to substance use disorder. So it's actually a continuum. Prevention is very comprehensive, okay? And the broader aim of drug prevention is to realize the potential of these young people so that they become productive citizens or members of the community and society in general, so that they will be able to maximize their potential and become meaningful members of society. Let's look at the global context. Based on the World Drug Report that was released by the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime last June 26, 2020, so this is the latest figure from the UNODC, in 2018, we had 269 million drug users. And this is 5.3% of the global population. Remember, 5.3%. Why am I emphasizing this? Because we need to remind our young people that the majority are non-users. Okay? So at least 95% of the population are not drug users. So please emphasize, in doing prevention messaging, let us emphasize that majority are non-users. Why is this important? Because many young people have this notion that everyone's doing it, okay? So it's a bandwagon effect. Like, I need to smoke, I need to drink alcohol because all my friends are doing the activity. That's not true. Majority are non-users, okay? So please remember this message. Tell our young people, majority are non-users. USEC Earl Saavedra mentioned the Philippine Anti-Illegal Drug Strategy. This is the National Plan of Action. Okay, and the main components of the anti-drug strategy are two, very important. Drug supply reduction and drug demand reduction. The school has a very important role in both. Okay, when it comes to drug supply reduction, that's why you have policies, okay, in school, drug-free schools, okay, drug-free school policy, so that you won't have alcohol, tobacco, and of course, illegal drugs inside the school premises. But the most important role is really on the drug demand reduction side. So that's why we provide education, we provide life skills, development trainings for our Barkada Contra Droga, okay, members, because we would like to really take an active role in the drug demand reduction initiative of the government. So please remember, this is a balanced approach. Equally important, this is the National Plan of Action Against Drugs, drug supply reduction, and drug demand reduction. And our goal is drug-free communities by 2022. So that is our aim. For some of you are actually asking, why is substance use the term being used now instead of substance abuse or substance misuse? Why substance use? Okay, the reason is that substance use is actually a spectrum. So meaning it has different levels. A person may have mild, okay, substance use issue, another may be moderate, another may be severe. So in how do we know whether the person has a mild, moderate, or severe issue of substance use? Well, the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual, the fifth edition, okay, this is the DSM-5, Diagnostic and Statistical Manual for Mental Disorders, that was actually produced by the American Psychiatric Association, okay, came up with a criteria for substance use disorder and severity scale. So we have here 11 points. Okay, number one is hazardous use. Social or interpersonal problems related to use. So maybe the person has trouble relating with family, with friends, okay? Number three is neglected major roles to use, okay? Withdrawal. Withdrawal is the unpleasant sensations, the unpleasant symptoms that the person experiences whenever he or she stops using drugs or substances. Tolerance is the need to increase the dosage so that the person will get the effect, okay? And then number six is use larger amounts and for longer duration. Number seven is repeated attempts to quit or control use. Number eight is much time spent using. Number nine is physical or psychological problems related to use. Number 10 is activities given up to use. So instead of spending time with the family, the person decides to use the substance. So he or she gives up being with the family so that he or she will have time using psychoactive substances. And the last one is craving. So according to the DSM-5, if the person shows 2 to 3 criteria, then the person has mild substance use disorder. Okay? 4 to 5 criteria means moderate. 6 or more criteria means that you have a severe, okay, substance use disorder that necessitates treatment. So please remember that substance use is a neutral term because there are different levels of use, mild, moderate, and severe. And we can't use a one-size-fits-all approach. So the response, okay, that we need to give to the person should actually match the level of use, okay? So for a mild case, for instance, we can give them more on maybe life skills, more on life skills enhancement, and then the severe one would be for referral to treatment and rehabilitation. So I hope that it's now clear why the term substance use is being used instead of substance abuse. Because people can use substances, but may not be dependent on it. So they are not substance abusers, but only substance users. So substance use is a whole range of continuum. It's a spectrum from mild to severe. There's actually a model, the protective and risk factors model, that tries to explain substance use. Okay, so why do people use psychoactive substances? And it's quite striking or surprising that according to recent research, about 40 to 60% can be attributed to genetics. So there is genetic predisposition to substance use. This is quite surprising, right? Personally, when I learned this information, I was actually shocked that there is a genetic predisposition to substance use. And maybe this kind of information would help us be more compassionate to people who are having issues with substance use, because there is a genetic factor. And then there's also personality traits such as risk-taking, sensation-seeking, and impulsive behavior. So those people who have these personality traits have higher vulnerability to substance use. And overall health conditions, like if there are comorbid or coexisting health problems. So people who have mental health issues have higher vulnerability to substance use. Now let's look at risk factors in schools. So according to literature, there are several risk factors. So these factors increase the vulnerability to risk-taking behavior such as substance use. So school failure is one. And for teachers, okay, I know that most of you are teachers, please remember this, okay? Students who are underperforming are actually academically problematic, they have higher risk for substance use. So we need to really provide more time and more attention to these learners. Low commitment to school. So if they don't have the motivation, they have very poor motivation to studying, and they are rejected by peers. So you can see a particular student working alone all the time. They are social isolated, they are actually vulnerable to substance use. And if they are associated with deviant and substance using peers, as they say, tell me who your friends are and I'll tell you who you are. So if these students are keeping bad company, please watch out for them, because they have high risk for substance use. So if we have risk factors, we also have protective factors like academic achievement or academic competence. If we have preventive drug education in school, we are so lucky because the Department of Education has the National Drug Education Program, and you have the Barkada Contra Droga as a key component of the NDEP. And then if we have strong neighborhood attachments, especially now in the time of the pandemic, so having a close interaction with people, even virtually, that is actually very helpful. Parents' attitudes and the kind of home they provide. So if the parents are loving, they're very supportive, that is a very good protective factor. By the way, protective factors decreases, okay, the likelihood that somebody will use substances or psychoactive substances. And then enforcement of limits and discipline, forming strong bonds with children, and monitoring children. So please monitor your children. For those of you who are parents, especially now that many of them are using gadgets, okay, please monitor what they are watching and what they're doing online. So why are adolescents more vulnerable to risky behavior? Let us understand, okay, why is it that adolescents are highly susceptible to risk-taking behaviors? Well, as you can see from this image, teen brain is still under construction. And many of us are aware of this, okay? The teen brain development, so our brain develops from back to front. So the last part that develops is the frontal part. And the limbic system here is in charge of our physical coordination, emotion, and motivation. This develops earlier than the frontal part. The sad fact is that the prefrontal cortex is in charge of reasoning, organizing, prioritizing information, judgment, control of impulses, decision making. And this is not fully mature until age 25. So what can we imply from what is this trying to tell us? Young people usually decide based on their emotions, right? So now you realize why it's very important for adults like us to guide our young people to make wise decisions, because the prefrontal cortex is not yet fully developed. So let us guide them in making wise decisions in life. So what are the highest risk periods among young people? Research has shown that key risk periods are during major transitions in the youth's life. So if we are now aware that the teen brain is not fully developed, we should also be aware that they are particularly vulnerable during the major transitions in their lives. Like when they are about to transition from elementary to high school, okay? So from grade 6 to grade 7, and then from junior to senior high school, so from grade 10 to grade 11, and then senior high school to college or work, so from grade 12 to college, and especially now that we are in the midst of a pandemic, this is particularly a stressful time for all of us, especially for our young people. And according to several information that's coming out, there's an increasing trend in substance use all over the world, so we better watch out for our young people. Here you can see the substance use initiation actually starts from middle childhood to early adolescence. You can see from this line graph that the initiation is actually around, okay, it rises starting 10 years old, okay, and then up to 15. So what is the implication of this? Prevention program should start as early as possible so that we will be able to prevent them from using psychoactive substances. So we need to start as early as possible. Actually, in the International Standards on Drug Use Prevention, there's even a program for pregnant women. So you start from pregnant women, so from the womb, okay, until adulthood. So it's good that in the K-12 curriculum, in the health education curriculum of the Department of Education, we have included, okay, the psychoactive substances, the gateway substances, as early as grade 4, okay, medicines in grade 4, and then grade 5, we talked about the negative effects of tobacco and alcohol. And it is very important that we remember the different prevention principles, okay? So in general, in whatever setting, there are 9 principles that we need to observe when we implement prevention programs. Number one is that it should have multiple components and settings. So we need to combine. So when we talk about components, they should include not only content, okay, but also strategies, the delivery. Settings would include here a combination of family. Okay, so there should be a program that targets the family, the school, the community, and the workplace, and even through media. Varied strategies and skills-based components. So instead of a lecture-based session, why not make use of active approaches like role-playing, okay, creative activities, and more on the development of skills, life skills that are very important, like communication skills, assertiveness, social skills, okay, refusal skills, or resistance skills, how to say no. In 2018, we had personal and social skills development program for high school students. It was participated by 3 schools in Metro Manila. Navotas National High School, then we have Andres Bonifacio Integrated School, and San Juan National High School. We were able to train them, okay? So this is a peer-based program, and we found out through a qualitative study that this young people really appreciate having their peers teach them about life skills. So I guess that is a very promising program, peer-based approach, because young people don't like to listen to adults. They listen more to their peers, to their friends. So that particular program trained, okay, a core group of model peers. They were trained on life skills, and then they were asked to deliver the program to their peers. So all of these are high school students. So use of multiple strategies, active strategies, instead of lecture or didactic approaches. Make use of active approaches, okay? Number three, sufficient dosage. So this is the contact time. How many sessions? How long per session? So it says that one time, big time activity does not work. I remember when we were in my basic education, usually there would be a one-time event and there would be a resource person who would talk about substance use prevention. And that is actually ineffective. One-time, big-time approach is ineffective. So the good thing is that many schools are now doing programs, okay, especially with the Barkada Contra Droga. So several activities, several life skill sessions, and booster session is also very important. So you need to be able to come up with a program with several components and spread that out all throughout the year and provide booster session. So I think we need to revisit that, because now we are in a remote learning modality. How are we going to translate that into remote learning? Number four, it should be theory driven. So remember, the theory is very important in guiding us in choosing particular strategies and programs that would meet the needs of the target population. So a good prevention program should be theory driven. There are a lot of theories, right? I know that you have your favorite theories. If I'm going to ask you, if you are a theory, what theory would you be and why? So, and if I'm going to maybe ask you what is your favorite theory, maybe some of you would say Maslow's hierarchy of needs. That's the theory, that's the needs theory, or maybe the social learning theory. In health, education, and promotion, and in prevention science, we use the popular theories are the Bronfenbrenner ecological theory. If you know the system, the different systems. And then, of course, we also talk about the stages of change. You remember the pre-contemplation, preparation, okay, action, maintenance, and then you can actually relapse at any point. So that's the stages of change. But the most popular in prevention science is actually the theory of planned behavior. It's an expanded theory of reasoned action. Basically, the theory of planned behavior is telling us that our behavior is actually a product of our belief. So if we would like to change the behavior of another person, first what we need to do is to change the belief of that person. Remember that there is no perfect theory, okay? So you need to actually look into the most appropriate theory given a particular context. The number five principle is to develop positive relationships. This is very important. So having the trusting relationship when you are working with young people, that is actually very basic. So you need to develop rapport and supportive relationship. Number six is it should be developmentally appropriate. I know that this is a key element. So we all know that the approach in teaching children, for instance, is very much different when it comes to, if you compare that with teaching in college. So the strategies that you need to use are actually different. So we have pedagogy and andragogy. So pedagogy for children and young people, for adults, and we have andragogy. So just like that, it should be developmentally appropriate. And then it should be also socioculturally relevant. That's why there are programs that we need to adapt to the local context. So I remember the universal prevention curriculum when we were actually part of the first cohort. And the material for the universal prevention curriculum was piloted to us. Many of our feedback actually is on the Western images, okay, and examples. They're very much foreign to us. So we told the curriculum developer to actually make it more flexible so that it can be adapted to different contexts, okay? And so that it would reflect Asian values, Filipino values, okay? And to make it more relatable. Next is that, this is very important, number 8. So any program should have a monitoring and evaluation mechanism in place. And remember, evaluation is not just at the end. It should be all throughout the program. So from start to middle, to end. Okay. In education, I know that many of you are familiar with formative assessment and summative assessment. So it's just like that. So you need to monitor. So you have a plan. Okay. Some of you may be familiar with the logic model. So the logic model, wherein you have your situational analysis, and then of course you identify your inputs, your activities, your outputs, and your outcomes. And you can use your logic model as also a monitoring and evaluation tool. Okay, so you compare. So if you have your action plan, when you monitor, you compare the progress based on your plan, and then you do corrective action. Then for evaluation, you ask yourself, were you able to achieve your objectives? Just like doing lesson plan, right? So it should be congruent. You have your lesson objectives, then you have your assessment. So your evaluation should be able to gauge whether you were able to attain your lesson objectives or not. So the evaluation mechanism is very important for us to know whether our program is working or not. Or has it been successful in delivering the intended objective or not? And lastly, our program should have well-trained program implementers. That is why I would like to commend the School Health Division of the Department of Education for prioritizing the Universal Prevention Curriculum. I know that we are actually the only country in the world, yeah, that was able to disseminate the UPC in the grassroots in terms of the school setting. So we have We do not only have global master trainers for the UPC, we also have national master trainers. And in the DepEd, we have UPC family all over the country. So all regions. Congratulations to the DepEd for that. And shout out to all the UPC trained and the coordinators and other staff that who are actually watching right now. So now let's proceed to the most important part, the school as a target setting. So Dr. Dumlao said that next to the family, the school is the most important agent of socialization. There are a lot of things that we learn from school, not only the content, not only the curriculum, but there's also a hidden curriculum, okay? The unwritten rules and protocols that we have in school, the rules of action, okay? So schools matter in prevention because the school shapes our attitude towards responsible behavior. So there are rules that we need to follow. It sets the guidelines, what is ethical and what is not. And it teaches appropriate pro-social roles and reinforces positive behaviors that we learned at home in the community. So it's the school actually has a very strategic role in prevention because it has a captured audience. Right? It is a captured audience, and it can provide an opportunity for young people to practice these roles and behaviors under adult supervision. I'm talking about the pre-pandemic setup, right? Because I'm talking about the physical infrastructure wherein you have your students, you have your captured audience, and then there's an opportunity to do a lot of activities with them, and you have the teacher supervising these students. But I know that with the remote learning modality, this will change. And I have another webinar on this, on reimagining preventive drug education in the new normal. So it's going to happen next. Okay, so now let's focus on the three roles of the school when it comes to prevention. So again, I borrowed this slide from the DepEd School Health Division, and they were able to come up with a very good way of summarizing, okay, the roles of the school. So I'm going to start off with the supply reduction. So this is actually focused on having clear and consistently enforced policies targeting the sale and use of all substances on and near school grounds and at all school-sponsored events. So, of course, it's clear that alcohol and tobacco are not allowed inside the school. That is part of supply reduction. Okay. For the demand reduction side, this is the most important role of the school. So we need to actually do prevention prevention programs. So we have the NDEP, we have the curriculum on preventive drug education, because we need to build the solid values, norms, beliefs, and attitudes against psychoactive substance use. Okay. And then, of course, developing the refusal skills of our students. Another role is to reduce the adverse consequences of substance use, meaning we treat our students who are problem users, we treat them with compassion, and then we provide a referral mechanism for them. So there should be a support mechanism for those already using in order for them to be able to have access to services. Okay, so I would like to emphasize that effective substance use prevention programs have been linked to academic achievement and dropout prevention. So prevention works. So schools can make a lot of difference. And there are four things, okay, that the school can do when it comes to substance use prevention. The number one is, of course, on physical setting. Second is on policies. Third is in culture and climate. The last one would be on program. So let's start off with the school's physical setting. I'm so happy to know that all of our schools are drug-free schools, right? So we are actually following this principle, safe and health-promoting environment, school environment, free from psychoactive substances. So that's part of the physical setting. Although, because of the pandemic, we are now working from home and doing modular instruction. Maybe in the future, post COVID-19, maybe we can do the face-to-face interaction again. I really miss seeing you face-to-face. Then we also have the first one is the physical environment, okay? This one, the physical setting. The second is on school policies. So the Department of Education was able to harmonize all your DepEd issuances, okay, last year. So you have a harmonized version of all those DepEd policies. And I know that it was actually very, very comprehensive when it was done last year. So let's review the guidelines for the school policies. Number one, no substance use on school premises by teachers. Teachers, no smoking, no drinking alcohol inside the school. We need to be good role models. So for staff and students, of course, no substance use for everyone on the school premises. Policies should be transparent and non-punitive. Please remember this. It should be transparent. It should be communicated well, okay, disseminated to all stakeholders, and it should be non-punitive. So there should be no suspension or dismissal. Instead, it should be something that is compassionate, okay, and will help the student to reform. Number three, interventions and policies are universal but may include selective components like cessation, support, and referral. At this point, let me just clarify what universal and selective are, okay? When you say universal, this is a program that targets everyone. It's for the general population. So if you have a universal program, this is for all the students. When you say selective intervention, this targets a vulnerable group. So for instance, if you are doing a program that targets the identified students in your school who are actually highly susceptible to risk-taking behaviors because of risk factors like they came from very poor environment, okay? They have a not-so-healthy family background. So if you have those interventions, they are called selective. So if you are targeting high-risk groups, you are doing selective prevention program. And last one, it should be implemented jointly with other prevention interventions. So it should be a comprehensive program, okay? So you should combine school policy with skills-based education, your life skills training, your barkada contra droga, if you have supporting parenting skills and parental involvement. So involve the parents and the community members. That is very important. Now let's move on to school evidence-based prevention program and policies. Okay, so for policies, it should be clearly specific what substances are target and what locations and or occasions they apply. By the way, this slide is from the International Standards on Drug Use Prevention. So I'm reading now the characteristics of the content of the policy that is linked to positive outcomes, okay? So this should be done, okay? Our policy should reduce or eliminate availability of and access to tobacco, alcohol, and other drugs. It addresses infractions of substance use policies with positive sanctions, providing referral to counseling or other support services, not punishment. It supports normal school functioning, not disruption. It supports positive school ethos and commitment to school and student participation. So all of these things are linked to positive outcomes. Remember, don't do the one which is linked to no or negative outcomes, which is punish infractions of substance use policies such as suspension or expulsion. The last one is actually very much controversial because we have this, okay, the random drug testing. So according to the international standards, it shouldn't be a stand-alone activity. So in order for random drug testing to be effective, it should be part of a comprehensive program on prevention. So just to wrap up, okay, when it comes to school culture and climate, we have positive discipline, psychological safety. So this is safety against discrimination, bullying, and other form of harassment. There should be cultural competence, okay? So you need to be culture sensitive. And there should be a good partnership between the home and the school. There should be consistent message between the parents and the teachers. Because if there is a problem with that, then the learner would have cognitive dissonance. What is that? This happens when you have a confusing message. So for instance, the teacher would say, you know, children is smoking has a lot of negative consequences. It can, you can have lung cancer and a lot more. And then the learner would go home and then the father would ask him to buy a cigarette. So there is a conflicting message and the learner gets confused. That what happens when you have cognitive dissonance. So in order to avoid that, there should be a strong partnership between the school home and the school. And of course, school connectedness. This is the feeling of belongingness. This is the sense of pride that we have, okay? When you say, okay, I'm a student of Sorsogon National High School. That's true. So shout out to those who are from Sorsogon, especially to my former teachers in Sorsogon National High School. Just marhay na banggi sa into gabos. Thank you so much for watching. So these are the things that we need to consider when it comes to school culture and climate. We need to build a healthy climate. So how do we do this? There should be a very good relationship between the student and the teacher, the parent and the teacher to the administrator. So a healthy relationship among the various stakeholders. And of course, positive discipline, monitoring the activities of our learners and ensuring that they're culturally competent and they are safe, not only physically but also psychologically. And that feeling of connectedness is there. And first, I would like to mention the resiliency wheel. Okay, so for bonding and connectedness, there are actually 5 components that are very important. Please remember this. This is a very good model. So in order for us to build that high level of support within the school climate, we need to be able to teach life skills. Again, I talked about refusal skills, communication skills, okay, assertiveness skills, and other important skills in life, and having high supported expectation. So, because when you set a high expectation, you are telling your students that you need to maximize your potential. You can do this. I believe, I have faith in you. And then provide opportunities for meaningful participation. So actually, now that we are doing remote learning, that this is actually very important. We provide opportunities for them to participate in different ways. And establish clear and consistent boundaries. So these are now the rules and the guidelines that must be clear from the start. And another very important dimension of bonding and connectedness is to show care and support. So actually, one of the things that I usually tell my students is that you may forget all the lessons that you've learned from me, but I hope that you will remember how I made you feel in the classroom, because I consider them as my children. I don't have children of my own, so I consider my students as my children, and I shower them with all the love and support. And that is bonding and connectedness. And please remember the resiliency wheel, especially now that we are in amidst a crisis. It's important that we make each other feel loved and supported. So the school intervention and policies work within the microenvironment to positively affect learners' vulnerabilities. So let me just very quickly summarize this diagram. This is the ethology model that explains our beliefs, attitudes, and behaviors. So basically, we have the personal characteristics. So imagine that, okay, you as a person, you have your characteristics. You have your predisposition, you have your own motivations, your interests, your genetics, and everything that makes you you. That is your personal characteristic. And then you are situated in a context, so you have an environment, and this environment can be categorized into two. Your environment's micro-level environment, the second is your macro-level environment. So micro-level is the most proximate. This is the nearest to you, the most influential to you. So you can see here the micro-level environment includes your family, that is your first line of defense. Of course, your peers, you have your good friends, and then the school. I highlighted the school here in red, and the workplace. So remember this for family, peers, school, and workplace are part of your micro-level environment. Then, of course, you have the macro-level environment. So these are the distal influences. So we have economic, in terms of poverty, the social environment in general, and the physical environment. These are all part of the macro-level environment. So our personal characteristics actually interrelate with the micro and macro level environmental influences, and together they shape our beliefs, our attitudes, and our behaviors. So I told you a while ago that behavior is actually very complex because it's multifactorial. It's a product of our personal characteristics that interact with the micro and the macro level environments. So for now, before I go to the last part of this session, I would like you to do an alertness. I would like to do an alertness check. I would like you to do this exercise very quickly. Just follow the instruction. I want you to grab your left ear with your right hand. Are you doing it now? Grab your left ear with your right hand. Next, now grab your nose with your left hand. I'm assuming that you're doing, and now it's time to reverse. So you need to grab your right ear with your left hand, And now grab your nose with your right hand. You can do that alternating, just to make sure that you're still with me. Okay, so now let's proceed to the last part of the presentation. So I have here a diagram that shows the continuum of prevention practices. So I told you a while ago that when we do prevention, but use ineffective approaches, it might be harmful. So as you can see from this diagram, the harmful, okay, you have the iatrogenic or the harmful programs have been evaluated and shown to be harmful. And then next to that, you have ineffective. So these are programs with no positive effect or which has negative effect. We have the best practices. In the Philippines, we have a lot of this, best practices. There is no evidence yet because we haven't subjected this to randomized control trial or you haven't done research on this. That's why we call them best practices, okay? We've done it and we make it, so based on anecdotal evidence, it's okay, but we don't have experimental evidence. Okay, and going to the to my right, you can see promising. So promising approaches, we really think this will work, but we need time to prove it. So these are promising approaches. And second to the best one is the research-based. This program is based on sound theory informed by research. So we also call this theory informed or research informed. And the best one is what we call evidence-based. Okay, this program has been rigorously evaluated and shown to work. So they have conducted an experiment, okay, based on experimental research, and these programs have been proven to work. That's why we call them evidence-based. So of course, what we would like is to have evidence-based programs or at least research-based programs. So let's just review the documents, the literature that we have right now. So we have the resources from the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime. You can download this for free. Just Google the International Standards on Drug Use Prevention and you visit the UNODC website. You can find this. This is a document and you can find all the evidence-based programs there across settings. So family-based programs, school-based, workplace-based, community-based, and even media-based. And then this one is the 2018 second updated edition. So the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime worked with the World Health Organization to come up with this updated version of the international standards. So let's look at some of the programs. Okay, again, based on the international standards, we have three target population. I already described to you the universal and the selective, but let's just review. So when we say universal prevention, everyone is included. So it's for the general population. Then when we say selective, this is for the vulnerable group. Okay, so selective prevention. So vulnerable groups. So of course, those groups are involved in truancy, academic underachievement, offending, low banding, parenting styles, family conditions, which are actually putting these people at risk. If you have these vulnerable groups and you are targeting them, we call this program selective prevention programs. And the last one would be here at the bottom, you can see the indicated prevention. So the indicated prevention targets the susceptible or the vulnerable individual. So this includes young people, okay, or anyone who is already using but is not yet dependent. So in general, the school-based prevention program can be summarized into the universal selective indicated. And based on the international standards, I categorized them into these three. Okay, under universal, you have the prevention education based on personal and social skills and social influence, and school policy and culture. So we already discussed the different characteristics of the school policy. Selective, so it means this is for the vulnerable group. So again, the prevention education based on personal and social skills and social influence. And the last one, the indicated, which targets the vulnerable individual, the one who already using but is not yet dependent. So this is an individualized intervention. An example of this is addressing individual psychological vulnerabilities. So in general, I have here the whole thing. So this is from the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime, International Standards on Drug Use Prevention. You can see the different developmental stages from prenatal and infancy to early childhood, middle childhood, early adolescence, adolescence, and adulthood. But I'm going to focus on the school. So for the school setting, you can see here for the early childhood education is an evidence-based program. Middle childhood, you have the personal and social skills education, classroom management, pre-pandemic. And then, of course, you have policies to keep children in school. So the conditional cash transfer is actually an example of this. It's an EBI. And then for early adolescence to adolescence, we have prevention education based on social competence and influence, school-wide programs to enhance school attachment, and then school policies on substance use. So from early adolescence to adulthood. And for adolescents, indicated program is addressing individual vulnerabilities. Okay, so if you want a copy of this, you just download the UNODC International Standards on Drug Use Prevention, and you will find all the details there. So just to give you an example of an EB prevention program, this is the Botvin Life Skills Training. Okay, so this is an evidence-based program for schools. It was given to 7th, 8th, or 9th grade health classrooms that have received the core program. 8 45-minute sessions provided weekly. Okay, it teaches decision-making skills, stress management, communication skills, and peer resistance skills. So these are the characteristics of a program known as the Life Skills Training Program by Botvin. Another example is the Good Behavior Game. So this is for the grade one class. So what happens in the Good Behavior Game is that you're going to divide your class into heterogeneous teams. You need to exhibit a large poster with classroom rules, just like the one here. Okay, so you have there the class rules. We will be polite. We will work quietly. We will get out of our seats with permission. We will follow directions and other class rules. And then you're going to reward entire teams for each child's pro-social behavior. And don't reward when a child is disruptive. It is group contingent. So you see you have there the reward system. And then play for 10 minutes, 3 times a week, extend that time over the year, and make rewards more abstract. The Good Behavior Game is actually an evidence-based intervention. It has a lot of positive outcomes, even during the adulthood stage. So just to summarize what works and what does not work. So what works in substance use prevention? Evidence-based, comprehensive prevention program. So it should be multiple components, okay? It should be able to integrate different skills, okay? Coping, personal and social skills, for example. It should have interactive activities, not lecture. It should have structured series of sessions. It involves all stakeholders. So meaning you involve the parents, the community members, the administrators, the teachers, and the learners. It should provide booster sessions, no, not one time, big time. And it should be delivered by trained teachers and staff. So the NDEP coordinators and staff who are training the UPC, good job. Okay. What does not work? Fear arousal or scare tactics, as shown by evidence, it is linked to poor or negative outcomes. Information in specific substances. So in prevention, what we're going to make you remember is that when discussing the different substances, you just need to focus on the general effects. Do not discuss in detail. So for example, if you are talking to high school students, do not discuss every information about, for instance, shabu. Shabu has these characteristics, it has these effects. No, you just need to focus on the general effects. So when you use psychoactive substances, these are the general effects. If you're using stimulants, these are the general effects. If you're using depressants, these are the general effects. If you're doing or using psychedelics, these are the general effects. Do not focus on specific substances because you're just increasing the curiosity of the learner, and that is counterproductive. So just make it general. When you focus only on self-esteem or emotional education, that is also ineffective because it should be comprehensive. Not only self-esteem, but also skills. So there should be content, knowledge, there should be life skills, there should be self-esteem, okay, so it should be comprehensive. One-time, big-time drug lecture does not work. Unstructured and non-interactive sessions do not work. The use of testimonials of former drug users does not work. Okay, so these are the ineffective approaches that we should not follow. So in a nutshell, the school lesson is an important socialization agent that it is critical in substance use prevention. So again, next to the family, the school has a very important role in substance use prevention. Second, adolescents are particularly vulnerable to risk-taking behaviors because of physiological and environmental factors. So we talked about the teen brain as underdeveloped. And the school can make a lot of difference through physical setting, policies, culture and climate, and of course, programs. The school has a role in supply reduction, but most importantly, in demand reduction. This is primarily our role, demand reduction, and in reducing the adverse consequences of substance use. It takes the engagement of all stakeholders to ensure that prevention interventions work. It takes a village to educate a child. Takes a village to deliver an effective substance use prevention intervention in the school. Another thing that I would like to emphasize before I end is that there is a notion that people, young people especially who use drugs, say that drug use or psychoactive substance use is their lifestyle. So we who advocate for healthy lifestyle, we need to provide them with helpful alternatives. So instead of using psychoactive substances, there are a lot of things that we can do, okay? Something that is related to our spiritual wellness, something that is related to our mental wellness, our social, okay, and ethical wellness. Volunteering is actually very healthy. And of course, joining Barkada Contra Droga. I'm thinking of having a virtual platform for more prevention work. Now, what do you plan to do to advocate for evidence-based prevention in your school? So just choose one of these questions and then feel free to share your insights and your reactions, your feelings in the chat box. So thank you so much, everyone. I would like to end by sharing with you my own quotation. Teaching nourishes my mind, strengthens my heart, and nurtures my spirit. I don't do it for a living. It is my life. Again, thank you so much, everyone. Let us make our purpose and passion in drug prevention advocacy so that together we will be able to attain greater heights. Thank you, and I hope that you are able to get something from this e-lecture.
Wow, thank you very much, Prof.
In behalf of the City Schools Division of Dasmariñas Health and Nutrition Unit, we would like to thank you for joining us in our activity this afternoon. Let us all continue to support the National Drug Education Program for the benefit of our learners and personnel. Again, thank you very much and stay safe.